G'day, AJ Mahar here. In this video, I want to talk about, as the title says, externalizing in borderline personality disorder. So, why do people with borderline personality disorder often, unknowing to themselves, subconsciously externalize everything that they think, that they feel, that they're worried about, that they're scared of? It's all externalized. Why is that? Maybe some people with BPD really need to know that. Maybe some loved ones or people who are close to people with BPD would really, or who have been, or who are not sure they want to stay close, need to know. Well, it's the arrested emotional development that happens at or by the age of 2 years, and that's what leads to people being diagnosed with borderline personality disorder at a later age, like, you know, sometimes 15 to 18, but usually after 18. And the thing is, this emotional arrested development occurs because of attachment and abandonment trauma, or perceived attachment and abandonment trauma. So people with BPD have no known sense of stable self. And that's huge. People talk about it who have BPD a lot or write about it online, but I don't think they realize just how huge it is based on, you know, what they say around. That they, you know, they try to really, I think they think they know themselves. I think they know, they think they know themselves before they could actually know themselves, depending on where they're at, if they've had therapy or not, and where they're at in the process of that. But so the point is, they a lot of people with BPD, even when they've had some treatment, but they haven't got past that sort of hurdle yet of finding the lost authentic self, they think that they know themselves better anyway than they do. Because if they knew themselves better, they would relate better. Okay, so that's one key clue to watch for if you are close to or have a family member or something with BPD. And their achievements, like, well, you know, is there anything happening with this, like, what's happening with the lost sense of self and externalizing everything because they have no container of self? You know, are they changing anything about taking personal responsibility or being able to hold their own feelings, or is that still getting shot all over the place? That's an indicator nothing has changed. And often people with BPD don't realize to what degree or not that's not changed, or some do. So the other thing is that, you know, like I said, there's just no container of self. Now, nobody walks around really who doesn't have a personality disorder and says, I have a container of self. I know who I am. Because you don't think of it that way. But if you think about it, you know, for non-personality disorder people, averagely mentally healthy, like me, as I say, because like everybody has issues in life, right? But we know who we are, because we know what we like, we know what we value, we have core likes, needs, wants, values, these type of things. You know, we know maybe what we like to do for a hobby, recreation, who we want as a friend, how to relate to a partner, how to be mutual, reciprocal, take responsibility for ourselves. We know all of that because we know ourselves, and it's hugely a difference, you know. So people with borderline personality disorder, unlike narcissists, please hear that, they're not like narcissists. They need a lot of attention, and they're trying to live through you, but it's because they don't even have any self. So they're not trying to target, they're not trying to hurt you, but they're going to end up hurting you because they're externalizing everything. So this lack of container of self means that they can't hold positive or negative feelings, like, if at all, very long, or in any kind of consistent way. This is why when you start to try to love someone with borderline personality disorder, or you have an adult child and you love them, or, you know, it's been a partner situation, and, you know, or even the adult child trying to love the parent, and kids try. I tried to love my, you know, both cluster B, you know, comorbid but borderline parents. with comorbidity with other things. I tried to love him when I was a kid, but nothing was there. Nothing was coming back. And then a kid doesn't know what to do with that, right? So then you externalize everything because, and if you're the scapegoat child too, like I was, being narcissistically abused at the same time, and you're having trauma in your childhood, like I did, and many people do in many to different degrees, in 75% of cases of those who want to be diagnosed with BPD, then the thing is how, you know, you're losing, you don't have a self, because that arrested before around the age of two, and you don't know that. And so, where other kids in other situations, and maybe with just different temperaments, sometimes, well, in 25% of cases, with the, quote, good enough mother, it's different. So, the point is, anyway, that people who know themselves get through early childhood development and get to do all of the things that human beings need to do to be averagely mentally healthy, to not have borderline personality disorder, in essence. And so, people with BPD, because of this lack of self, they, most of them, and it depends, you know, people get better. I recovered in 1995. It's not true of me anymore. It's not true of some people. But people that are just still really, you know, not necessarily do they have to be younger, but in the active throes of BPD is what I refer to it as. Most of them don't know who they are. Most of them don't know what they want, even though they'll say, I want this, I want that, or but they don't know what they want. If you really ask them, what do you want right now? They probably won't be able to have a very cogent answer. And most don't know what they need. And then further to that, they don't know what the difference between what they want and what they need is. Because, you know, consciously, they're not very self-aware. So they might want something that's a need, but they think they just need what they want because they really don't know the difference between the two. I love how computers give you beepy messages all the time when you don't need it. Anyway, so, they don't know the difference between wants and needs, which is a very childlike way of thinking and being, right? So, because kids don't either, right? Like, you know, like a 1.5-year-old or a 2-year-old will pick up a toy and, like, be ensconced with it, or, I don't know, some electronic gadget now, game or something, for like, and then, drop that and move on to the next thing. And each thing that they drop, each thing that they thought they wanted or they needed or whatever, at a certain point in time, that they drop, young children, they will then move on to something else. And the thing they dropped is out of mind, out of sight, out of mind. People with BPD get emotionally arrested in their development before they get through separation, individuation, the rapprochement, you know, but I'll talk more about that in another video, what that is, that stage of development. And the other thing is they don't learn how to, they keep that young childlike mentality of a 2-year-old of out of sight, out of mind. You know, like throw a toy away and then go like, where is it? I want it, you know, like, and people with BPD are stuck in that emotional space. So they have magical thinking. That's how they think. And what does that really mean? Well, it just means that they're not really thinking as much. I mean, they can be thinking. They have intellectual capacity. But in interrelating with people or how they think have you noticed how often people with BPD, whether you're watching them on YouTube or whether you have one in your life, say, I feel this, I feel that. Well, it felt this way, and it felt like you didn't love me anymore. Not, I think you didn't, no, because magical thinking is a feeling of things, and thinking they're as real as, like, actual rational things, because feelings aren't always rational. That's true of, you know, all of us. We can have a feeling is not rational, but we can have our rational mind working at the same time with that feeling in a paradoxical way, so that we don't end up like people with BPD who are going to split the bad feeling from the good feeling, or they don't know the difference necessarily between a want or a need, or a feeling or a thought, because it's all happening so fast, and they're really emotionally young children. And I'm not saying that in any judgmental or stigmatizing or devaluing way. It's just the truth. So this externalizing is just happening massively on every level in a myriad of ways with people with BPD just pretty much constantly. And they may or may not be aware of any of it. So this magical thinking, an example is like you're going to take a business trip and your partner with BPD thinks you're not coming back. You're going to abandon them. Like, do you have to go? Like, they can't stand the distance because distance equals abandonment. That's feeling, not thinking. That's not rational. So it's feeling, right? And another example would be, so you're texting, a friend texts you. Maybe you were sitting there chatting with whomever the person with BPD in your life is, and person texts you, and you get involved in a bit of a text conversation for a bit, or, you know, whatever the case, a couple people, you know, maybe 5-6 texts back and forth, or God knows, sometimes we get into them where they go longer. And I never enjoy that much, but, you know, it happens. The thing is, so then they might, that again, focus taken off of them. And again, it's not the same as narcissists, okay? Please hear that. But when the focus is taken off of them, they feel like you don't love them anymore. You don't care about them anymore. Or you'd be like talking to them and not texting somebody else. Paying attention to them. There for them. So it's not like they demand it. It's just what happens inside because they're so childlike and don't have a self. Childlike emotionally and don't have a self. So they're often subconsciously expecting others to understand them. Understand them, understand they're suffering from this, they're suffering from that, this is happening. Well, you did this, you made me feel this way, you made me angry. Well, if you didn't do that, or if you had said this, or if you didn't say that. And all of that is the externalizing. It shows that they don't know how to take personal responsibility. And it is, to be fair to people with BPD, hard to learn to take personal responsibility when you don't know who you are. How are you going to do that exactly? So I'm not making an excuse for abuse, just saying it's a conundrum. It's an actual dilemma that people with BPD encounter, you know, moment to moment in their lives, or certainly like daily or often. So they don't understand others emotionally, but they expect others to totally understand their every want and need, like a young child would. And by the way, anybody who's close to them, even a friend or a partner, can be put really quickly in an object-other representation role of wounding parent or parent. And so that's how they relate often to partners. You know, it's like, you're going to meet my wants and needs, right? Because, you know, they don't know where they end and you begin. You're just an extension to them. But all of this is subconscious. All of this is about the lost self in BPD. This is not like what narcissists do at all. So I think what people with BPD really need to know is that they need to start to understand themselves. They really need to keep with therapy, find a better therapist, find somebody who knows more about how to work with people with BPD than a lot of therapists do, or a lot of therapists don't even want to work with people with BPD, which I think is ridiculous and unconscionable because, you know, well, if you don't know anything about it, yeah, but like, it's just not that taught, okay? What with a lot of people becoming mental health professionals, personality disorders are just not taught a whole lot. So anyway, I was going along fine here till I lost my place in my notes. But so anyway, yeah, this understanding thing, you know, like extension of self, it's all subconscious because there isn't even like a self formed enough in people with BPD, unless and until they get enough treatment to find that self, for them to even like know why they're feeling what they're feeling. They can maybe say what they're feeling, and then they'll accuse you of how you've caused them, made them feel that way, which isn't the case. And by the way, when somebody with BPD in your life is triggered, they'll say, well, you know, I got triggered, you did this and that, you triggered me, and I got triggered back, or I got triggered. Doesn't matter, because it's true for them. They get triggered, yes. And then they regress and or emotional dysregulation and dissociation. And then what they're screaming about or why they've walked away in silence, depending if it's the acting out or the acting in, the raging, you know, borderline or the quiet borderline. Not that quiet borderlines don't have rage. They just put it inward, not outward. But anyway, I don't want to make this too long. I just wanted to say that so they don't understand others emotionally, but they project out the inner affect states onto others. You know, so for example, like, you know, if they feel like you're too close, like they want to be close. They want to not be alone. They're afraid of being alone, afraid of abandonment. So they want to be close, but if they'll start to feel controlled. They'll start to feel engulfed. They won't know it, probably. But then they'll feel like you're controlling them because they're having anxiety with the closeness. Because they feel controlled. So then they feel like they're being controlled. They really then believe that you're controlling them. Because they feel it. Magical thinking. Therefore, it must be real. So they don't understand what's happening inside themselves because they don't know the self. Right? So the other thing is that, the way that you'll know that they've been too close, and many people know this already, that they feel too close and controlled, you know, is because they will distance in an angry or a silent way. Acting out borderline in an angry, rageful way, probably. In the quiet borderline in a silent, withdrawing way. And then both leave you going like, what? Because it's happening inside of them, but they're externalizing it out, and now it's happening to you, too. Whatever. You might not know what it is. They don't know what it is, either. And they'll often say that the triggers are your fault if you're a loved one or someone who's a friend of someone with BP or whatever the relationship. And the triggers aren't your fault. The triggers are their responsibility. The triggers are part of what happened to them in the past that they didn't ask for. And they were victimized, you know, in their young life. But they need to realize that they can't keep, externalizing those triggers as the person closest to them's fault. When that's not the case. So anyway, this is like they just externalize everything, and rather most people with BPD often feel like the other or you make them feel bad. Yeah, make them feel like shit, they say. Make them feel bad, make them feel wrong, make them feel horrible, make them feel unlovable. None of that is true. Those are triggers back to original attachment and or abandonment trauma. And when they originally felt that way, which did match probably the situation, unless it was just perceived, but then still that's pretty real. If it's perceived, they're still going to feel it's pretty real. When I'm talking about in young childhood. So in that bonding, that crucial time of bonding or not bonding of, you know, getting the arrested emotional development from abandonment and attachment trauma, perceived or actual. And so they believe you are making them feel angry, or you are making them feel whatever they think they're feeling, or believe they're feeling, or are feeling. So borderlines externalize and shift all responsibility for this lack of self, but for who they are, for the fact that they just did this or said that, they just externalize it all outward onto whomever else is there. And then what happens is they think or they perceive that it's you doing to them what they just felt. And that's not a conscious process. Borderlines often don't do well in groups of people. They externalize childlike need, constant one-on-one attention. And so if they feel like they're not getting what they need, then they start to split, they devalue. So externalizing in borderline personality disorder, just to summarize here, is at the root of so much of the even deeper intrapsychic, defensive, toxic relational dynamics that all arise with the loss of self and the pseudo-self, which I call the borderline false self, that is the absence, more than not, of who the borderline was meant to be, could have been, if they got through early childhood development, who they can still be if they will continue to go along the path of recovery with skilled people who know how to take people along that path of recovery to finding that lost self, they can still become that self they were meant to be. That's what happened to me in my recovery. And I always knew that I needed to find that self. I always kind of had a feeling that there was something about everything I was doing that wasn't really who I was, but I still had to take responsibility for what I was doing in the meantime. So, you know, I got through a lot of therapy, and even, you know, 25 years ago, I was much better, but like, well, you know, in 1990, but in 1995 is when I officially recovered. So the borderline false self, yeah, the absence of who that person should be or would be or could be or can still be, but isn't right now. It hasn't been since their emotional arrested development. But that otherwise, that burgeoning authentic self that was lost, psychologically killed, as Melanie Klein, object gradation theorist, put it so well, and I'm just not using the exact quote, I'm changing the words around. So the authentic self was lost and psychologically killed due to arrested emotional, well, that's what causes the arrested emotional development, but it's due to abandonment and attachment trauma, actual or perceived. So it's really important to just know that whenever people with BPD are saying things, they often don't realize that what they're saying is the externalizing of everything they feel, or why this happened or why that happened, until they can start to get an idea of taking some personal responsibility through therapy, an idea of kind of who they are, but they still won't really know who they are because they'll still have all this sort of what becomes in an adult when it's childlike, okay, the way they relate interpersonally, toxic, you know, it's a toxic way of relating, and it really affects other people, and it hurts other people, and people with BPD sometimes understand that, you know, when they get maybe partway down the road to recovery, but if they're just not getting help, or they're in denial, then they don't have a clue how they're affecting you, and yet they want you to understand them. So here's the ultimate projection of the externalizing of everything in borderline personality disorder by people who have borderline personality disorder. They think that other people just need to understand that they are suffering. They are in pain, but the suffering. You know, pain is inevitable in life for all of us, BPD or not, at some point or other, you know, now and again, to different varying degrees. But suffering is optional. Suffering is a choice. Pain is inevitable. Suffering is a choice. Now, people with BPD will probably get really ticked if they watch this, but it's an important point, and it's a hard one to grasp from having BPD. But it's important on the road to recovery. And so the last thing I just wanted to say here was, so with all this externalizing, people with BPD are convinced that you just need to understand them better, that you don't care about them enough to understand them, that you don't realize that they're in pain. They would say suffering, okay, fine, but they're in pain, that they have legitimate pain from childhood, that a lot of them have been through trauma, and they don't have a self because of abandonment and or attachment trauma, and that kind of trauma means they don't know how to love, they don't know how to connect, they don't know how to bond in healthy ways. So what they are often saying on YouTube or writing or all over the internet and to people in their lives is, you know, you don't understand me, you just need to understand. In other words, you need to make a lot of allowance for what's going on and how you're getting hurt and what they don't realize they're doing a lot of the time and how they don't take personal responsibility because they don't have a known sense of self. So they're totally lost and trying to live through you. And so they don't necessarily know that. They don't have boundaries. All these different issues of externalization because there's no self to internalize anything unless and until enough therapy and the finding of that self. So it's really important to know that there is this, it's the false self in borderline personality disorder, the borderline false self that rises up in the space that's been left by the psychological death of the otherwise burgeoning authentic self. So then there's just this void, not like the narcissist void, it's different, where the person should be, but they're not, and the false self rises up to protect because there's nobody there. And I'm talking about emotionally, you know, as evolving through childhood and growing up emotionally. So that's really why so many people on the other side of people with BPD are flummoxed, confused, trying to rescue, feeling for them. And I think it's fine to do that, just not to the detriment of yourself while you're being abused. But I think that borderlines do deserve empathy. And they often have empathy, but then there's all these interruptions to what they feel and what's going on and what they can't know because yet or until they get enough help because they don't know who they are. And that self really is lost. And so much of what they do is subconscious, but the effect on others, they don't understand. And so just the last thing I'm going to say here is, because I went a little longer than I wanted to, is so they continue to say, and borderlines continue to feel that you just don't understand, you don't care enough, or you don't love them enough, or you're a mean person, or you're horrible, or you're just trying to say they're unlovable, or you're really hurting them so badly, making them feel all this stuff, when really that's the ultimate projection and externalization. They are lost, they are hurt. They are wounded. Yes, they're defending everything like, I don't want to say like crazy because it's not crazy really. It just seems crazy later in life, like beyond childhood. But, so, it's the ultimate projection of how they are affecting and hurting others that they think you're re-traumatizing them. That's the repetition compulsion cycle of, you know, idealizing, devaluing, splitting, black and white thinking, no sense of self, the magical thing, all of it. That really is the tragedy of what borderlines have to experience, people with BPD, until unless they get enough help and get through, quite a ways on the path toward recovery, if not ultimately to recovery. But then there are a lot of people with BPD online, YouTube, blogs, all over the place, saying that they are recovered and thinking that they are recovered when really it's obvious to people that they're not. So it's hard for people with BPD to know where they are until you really get, and I remember my process, doubting, not being sure, until you really get to where you really do know. But in the meantime, also I'll just say, people who have, and it's now between 37 to 42% of people diagnosed with borderline personality disorder also have comorbidity narcissistic personality disorder. So that's what we're seeing in some people online saying some things too, and maybe they're not aware. But this is what's, you know, that plus the way that they then are with people that are close to them leads so many to keep thinking that, you know, BPD and NPD are the same personality disorder, and they're not. They have some overlapping similarities, but there's a whole lot of differences. So anyway, borderlines, I shouldn't say borderlines, because it's not their identity. People with BPD, but yeah, we use that, you know, that word. I don't mean it in a bad way. Borderlines externalize everything because there's nowhere inside to hold it, put it, understand it, or even have a self-reference for it. And they don't have a self-other reference because they don't have a self from which to reference where the boundary might be between them and other, or them and the loved one, them and maybe you. So, externalizing in borderline personality disorder is caused by the abandonment trauma and or attachment trauma that causes the emotional arrested development by the age of two that psychologically kills the otherwise, you know, child that would have developed into a person who knew themselves. And so it's not insanity or really pathological, but the way that people behave so childlike and for these reasons with BPD when they're older, emotionally, interpersonally relating toxically because there's no self from which to have any authentic, they can't know anything more than this lostness and confusion and pain until they go and get help. And I'm not making any excuses for abuse, but that's just the way it is. But then also, so many people with BPD who are looking to the internet to be their source of recovery or their source of healing or their source of knowledge, on three quarters of the internet, and I've had other people say this is not just my opinion or me, and I'm not saying, well, but I do happen to know BPD inside out, okay? I'm just going to say that. I do. I mean, I do. Is that a claim to fame? I'm not so sure it is. You know what I mean? I had to go through a hell of a lot, and that was like, you know, but that's in my past now. But so, this whole idea that you're supposed to somehow understand them, rescue them, and fix them, which only enables them, is because they are not demanding, but in a way crying out so much in many different ways, not necessarily crying, with this childlike sort of like, but help me. Like they're trying to live through you because they don't have that self. So, you know, I think that's a source for why there should be empathy for people with BPD. But obviously, if you've just been really hurt by someone, it's going to be hard to have that empathy. But the other thing I just want to stress in closing, and I always say I'm closing and I keep talking, but really in closing here, is people with borderline personality disorder have a lot of commonality in the origin of the reason why they have issues and challenges and don't have a sense of self and try to live through others and don't have boundaries. And no matter if they have something else comorbid or not, they are codependent as well. The point is that they just keep on thinking they're so misunderstood because they don't understand themselves. And so they have no reference for other to understand what you're going through. And if you've ever tried to explain it to somebody with BPD, how you're feeling and what you're experiencing, as you know, those 3 to 5 to 8 hour conversations, you might think you're just about to get there and then the bottom falls out because they just don't have any way to take it in. They just don't have any way to get it till they go through enough therapy to get it. And in the meantime, I just want loved ones or non-personality disorder people to know that if somebody in your life with BPD keeps on saying you're making them feel like shit and you're triggering them and you're doing this and that to them, because that's really what they think. It's really how they feel. It's all they know, other reference, even though they don't know what's happening to other, because they're stuck in this lack of self. So a lot of damage can be done, though, to others. But, you know, a lot of damage was done to people who develop borderline personality disorder, who go on to be diagnosed with it. And so I just think we need to try to break through stigma. We need to try to understand more. But I will say in all honesty that so many of the clients I've had over the years and continue to have who are close to someone with borderline personality disorder in any type of relationship or adult children, it doesn't matter, friends, partners, ex-partners, parents of, that they try. So I want people with BPD, if you listen to this video, if you watch this video, to know that people are trying to understand you. Even harder than you might be, but you don't maybe realize yet that you don't understand you at all. And then that gives you a faulty, cognitive, distorted idea about how you understand other people and what is going on relationally. So, and that's what non-personality disorder people really need to understand, because there can come a time with many people with BPD when you need to leave a relationship because you need harm reduction for yourself. You're starting to lose yourself. And that's not anything against a person with BPD in particular. That's about people taking care of themselves and people being responsible for themselves. But people with BPD don't know that yet, so they just feel it's abandonment, or that everybody like me who talks about it is just trying to say, leave them, don't care about them. It's not true. We should always care about them. But sometimes you can't stay with somebody no matter how much you care about them, or they won't even let you care about them, or they can't believe that you care about them in any consistent way. Dilemma all around, and pain on both sides. So I think if we can acknowledge that, people with BPD and people who have been hurt by people with BPD and all the kind of like chaos, drama, pain, and agony in the middle. We should at least not, you know, if you've been hurt by somebody with BPD, don't think that every single person with BPD is just like the person that might have really traumatized you who had BPD. Because it's not true that they're all alike or that they all manifest the same things the same way. Quiet borderlines are vastly different from acting out borderlines. And they all have the same common core kind of issues why they get diagnosed with BPD, but then the manifestations can be infinitesimal. Because for each person with BPD, there's going to just be a little bit of individuality in some aspect of all this, but not the reality and aspect and what it means. All the externalizing, projecting out, and externalizing that goes on with people with BPD, because everything that they think, that they feel, how they devalue, the whole splitting process, the repetition compulsions, the trying to, you know, dissociatively resolve old childhood issues, but like in the now, because it's dissociative to them, it's triggered back, they don't understand the difference until they learn how to understand the difference. All of that is as a result of the person with BPD having no self, and It's all they can do is externalize everything, including that they don't know how to take personal responsibility. And for some people, this goes on for a lifetime, but that's because they don't choose to get help. People who really want to get help can be helped, because borderline personality disorder does not have to be a lifetime sentence. But in the meantime, a lot of people need harm reduction who are too close to people with BPD. And that doesn't mean, if you're somebody with BPD, please hear this. It doesn't mean that they think that some people end up in different ways, states of feeling. But not everybody leaves people with BPD that they leave out of hate or with loathing or super negative thoughts. They need their own harm reduction. They need to take care of themselves, maybe some children involved. They need to be responsible for themselves. They know where they end and you begin, and they know what is happening to them, and people with BPD may often not know. So the point is, anyway, we need to try to find a way for understanding to be not just people with BPD saying, well, you don't understand, you don't care, you're, because these people around you are trying to understand more than you know. And really, people with BPD who are still at this stage, you're the ones who need to learn to understand so much more. You can recover by starting to do that. And then you can be wholly different and have a different experience in your own finding of yourself, in yourself. And then the way you relate to others will change. And then the way they relate back to you will change. So I hope that was helpful. Take care. I...